started to recover. So governments will feel, okay, we've done our job, it's better, so they're going to start cutting expenses a little bit. They're going to stop printing money or reduce the amount of printing money, and it will take a little bit of time, but then the inflationary forces will, again, surface. And as soon as that happens, investors will wake up and say, wow, this is, you know, actually not very good, and then stocks will go back down. And in terms of timing, again, it's very difficult, but I would say there's not much left in the upswing here, because we already see governments talking about cutting expenses. There's a lot of, even in the U.S., a lot of people, a lot of politicians that don't like running those massive deficits. And even in the polls, a lot of people are worried about massive deficit in the U.S. So there's already a little, very early, but trend toward trying to be more reasonable.
So that's interesting that you're taking this inflationary, deflationary kind of cycle, because you got people like John Paulson. He's betting heavily through his new gold fund on an inflationary spiral. And you've got, on the other hand, you've got Bill Gross, who's betting heavily on the deflationary spiral, and we've got you kind of in between playing ping pong. What happens to gold during all this time? So let's go into some commodities. Because gold is, we'll talk about oil and base metals in a second, because those are more driven by world economic growth and supply and demand, maybe more so than gold. But first, let's talk about gold. What happens to gold during this period? Is there so much unrest and so much instability that gold continues to be the safe haven, or will gold just rebound back and forth through your expected inflation and deflationary spirals?
Look at round one and round two, 2008 and 2009. I mean, gold went down with everything else last year in 2008, and gold went up with everything else in 2009. So I personally think that as the match is going on, gold will move with whoever looks like is winning. So if deflation looks like is winning, gold is probably going to correct with all the other asset classes. And when it looks like inflation is winning, like in 2009, I think gold will rise like most other asset class. And just, George, if I can go back to your comment about Paulson and Mr. Bill Gross.
Sure.
I mean, I think they're talking, those two guys talk about different things. Like, I like my analogy of a boxing match. Nine rounds. Like Bill Gross is talking probably about the third round. So the next round is going to be deflation again. So he's talking because deflation is still there, and another wave of deflation is coming, so therefore deflation is winning, but it's only the third round. And Paulson is probably talking about the ultimate outcome, which is the whole match. At the end, when the judges say who won, but, you know, I think personally, like Paulson, I think ultimately inflation and hyperinflation potentially would win, but it's not going to be until the match is over. So we'll have many rounds before we know the outcome and the ultimate winner.
All right, so what do you suggest the investors and even a lot of fund managers that are listening right now, because we know a lot of people are tuning in to listen to you. Do you, if Paulson's going to come out on top with the inflationary spiral, do we just buy gold, hold long, even hold it through cycles, and in fact add to positions as gold maybe takes expected hits as you're expecting? Is that the way to be investing your money? Or, I mean, not all of it, obviously, but is that one winning strategy going forward?
It certainly could be, but if, let's say, I'm right in my expectations of deflation and inflation to alternatively win and surface, that means we're going to have a lot of volatility. Look at just what we just had in the last 2 years, massive correction, like massive, and then massive rally, one of the biggest and fastest rally we ever have seen.
Sure.
So. If you don't mind the volatility and you have a strong stomach, I mean, gold bullion is not as volatile as everything else, so it's fine to hold, because ultimately that's what I believe, that inflation will win. But if you're willing to be nimble and trade, I mean, you can make even more money. Not that it is easy. It's not easy, you know, but imagine if you had been away in 2008 and bought the bottom. I mean, you would have made tremendous amount of money. So there is tremendous amount of money to be made for investors that can try to figure out when inflation is winning and trying to figure out when there's a reversal and the other side is winning.
All right, so hindsight obviously is 20/20. It's easy to say if we had bought at the lows in March of 2009 or even 2008 when the market was dropping. But What do you see as ranges? Do you have any idea of ranges? And because obviously what you're telling people is going to be a great opportunity to be trading. What kind of signs are you going to look for specifically that are going to tell you that we're at the end of the inflation? I know you talked about earlier about things like governments talk about decreasing spending. That's one sign. But any hard technical data that you'd be looking for, any kind of technical analysis that you might be looking at, ratios, things like that?
I would look more at extension of the rallies, correction, and how big it is versus the historical norm. So we already are, in terms of rally, you know, above historical norms. So we have rallied from the bottom way more and way faster than in any time in the past, I believe, or at least one of the fastest moves ever. So we're already above. So that's one thing that, to me, says it's close to being over in terms of rallying. And I would look also at if everybody admits that everything is fine again, then you know that the other side is going to win again. So we already there. Like the third quarter GDP was up in most countries in the world. China data is very good. So governments start to say that, you know, the worst is behind us, and a lot of people are now optimistic again for the future. A lot of people out there believe. And I hear that on BNN, I hear that in many newspapers, that, you know, this is just a normal recession and now we're just in a normal recovery. I mean, world debt is at record highs. You have deficits that we've never seen in so many countries around the world. We are not at a normal time. And on top of that, we mentioned that before, but the leverage in the banking system is still huge and needs to be corrected.
Okay, that's great that you bring it up, because I want to go into a bit of I don't want to call it a fringe scenario, but definitely something people are thinking about, and that's this. SocGen, Société Générale, a few days ago came out with some words of advice for the worst-case scenario. They're not saying it's going to happen, but for the worst-case scenario. But as part of the worst-case scenario, they said public debt is going to explode, global public debt is going to explode within 2 years to $45 trillion. That's without any added spending. And that's going to be up 2.5 times just this decade. So here's a question I have for you. Can that money ever get paid back, Jeff? Is there really any chance that money's going to get paid back? And in fact, a deeper question might be, do governments ever actually intend to pay this back? Or are we potentially seeing a shift where at some point you have economies like China and governments like China say, we're no longer accepting your paper. We want gold, and maybe what we're looking at is a return to the gold system. Has the fiat paper system failed?
Yes and no. In one way, fiat money was great for many years because the world probably went through a much higher growth than we would have been if we had stayed on the gold standard. So a lot of people benefit out of higher than normal growth.
Sure.
But the system eventually will fail. In fact, it's failing right now, slowly, but we're going through a reset. I mean, the problem with when you run so many debt and so many deficits, whoever saves money, puts it at the bank, is the ultimate loser, because that money will be destroyed somehow by either, you know, the financial system's, you know, breakdown like we almost witnessed last year, or ultimately what I personally believe will be high inflation, even hyperinflation, where, you know, there's so much inflation that your dollar is not worth as much in next year, and it's not worth as much in the year after in purchasing power because there's so much inflation. So that's where the system fails. The system will be, fails in the sense that all the savers, all the people that did the right thing, you know, work hard, save money, unfortunately, a lot of those people will save, or their savings will be eroded slowly by tremendous inflation.
Okay, let's take off your hedge fund cap for a second, and let's speak to individual investors, because it's really interesting that you say that. If you're Joe Public, you've been working hard, you're putting cash away in the bank, you're paying down your debt, and you think you're doing the right thing, what kind of strategy do you recommend? And I don't mean giving anybody financial advice, but what kind of general strategies would you give to Joe Public out there and so that he doesn't get caught up, so he doesn't have his cash and savings eroded away by potential hyperinflation?
Yeah. If there is hyperinflation, like ultimately I think it will be. I mean, hard assets are probably going to be a good place to be. Gold certainly could be a very good place to be as well. even real estate. I think in Canada real estate is maybe a little bit high here and a little bit at risk, not in the short term, but real estate in Canada has done better. So but overall, real estate, if you're well financed and it's a lot of equity down, real estate also should be a good protector against high inflation.
And when you're talking about high inflation, are we talking about a return to the 1980s where you had gold back then hit its nominal high back then, and we had interest rates 21, 22, 23%? Is that what you mean by hyperinflation? I'm assuming you're not talking